Finally, we're finishing up the first part of this franchise. Surely there can't be that much more, right? Five parts? For now? Okay, no, that's fine. More content for me, I guess. So here we are, looking at Volume 3, the final part in Daughter of a Soldier, where Mine defies social norms, class roles, and comes out on top of everything. Or maybe she just dies and gets reincarnated again. Maybe that's the gimmick of this franchise, it's not like you know yet. What is for certain is that this volume is packed with side stories to bridge the gap between parts, as well as fill out the backstory that we didn't quite get. So expect this video to have a large chunk dedicated to just those. But before that, there should be like an obligatory subscribe animation somewhere around here. If you haven't, go ahead and follow its instructions. Helps me out. I hear that works if I stick it early in the video, so... we'll see. Got it? Good. Let's get into Volume 3, where Mine was on the cusp of death where we last left off. This one picks up mid-Mine Crisis, just, from the receiving end. Mine's passed out, and word is sent to the Guildmaster to prepare a magic tool, which is where our point of view character, Frida, steps in. She had received notice from her grandfather that Mine and Benna would arrive, so Frida walks into his office and pulls out a key from around her neck. This is to a safe that only she and Gustav have keys to, because inside, it contains a literal fortune's worth of old magic tools worn with age. So Frida has one last chance to say no to this whole deal when her servant asks if she really wants to go through with it. Frida signed a contract with a noble already to ensure her safety, but that could be nullified on a whim. That's, laughable after Volume 7. She may need these tools again one day, but she says that she's certain. Not only is Mine a proverbial goose who lays golden eggs, but she's Frida's friend, one who has the same disease and wants to do the same job as her, so this is clearly destiny at play. Plus, the price of this magic item, which Gustav told Benno was worth one small gold and two large silvers, but he was lying, since they're worth two small golds and eight large silvers. Frida thinks the nobles are ripping them off, and, they're really not. Well, not that bad at least. So since they're expecting Mine to have a huge debt, they're planning to have her sign with the Othmar company, Gustav's store, for her to pay them back. After all, Mine is worth at least a large gold coin in Frida's eyes. We now go to Mine, suffering from her nebulous heat dream as it slowly eats her. But suddenly she feels it vanishing, like it's being sucked away by a vacuum cleaner. So she tries to shove it into the vacuum, only to hear a loud snap. Then she wakes up. The next day at sunset. Yeah, over 24 hours later. So Mine's first thought is that she died again and was reincarnated as a noble. But that's not the case, because she can see that she's still Mine with her hands and hair. And Frida comes in a few minutes later to give her the full details. She passed out, it's obviously later, and Mine just broke a magic tool worth a lot of money. Mine, can afford it though, and realizes not just Gustav set her up, but Benno sort of did too, by offering her two small gold coins instead of three at first for the Rincham. So Frida explains that Mine's devouring isn't exactly cured. Sure, they sucked out her heat, but it'll build up again. The older she gets, the bigger the vessel for holding that heat, but also the quicker it builds up. So Mine needs to make a decision. Sign a contract with a noble as either a slave or mistress, or die. Because at most, that magic tool only bought her another year, and the Guildmaster refuses to sell more because Frida could need them again one day. Mine says she'll think about it and then passes out for the night. Also, a side note, Frida's contract is that of a mistress, not a slave. Yeah, considering she's seven, it's about as bad as it sounds. But hey, since Mine's at Frida's house, that means she can keep her promise and make sweets with her. After she wakes up, she sees how fancy the house really is, by having a furnished guest room with a canopy bed. Also a servant who instructs her to wash her face with warm water before going off to breakfast with Gustav and Frida. He tells Mine to think about her future while also lamenting Benno's forethought that allowed her to escape his store once again. Which sort of terrifies Mine. Seeing both Gustav and Frida in one place makes her basically screwed. Breakfast is good though, with white bread, honey, bacon, and eggs fit for a Japanese breakfast. And after she's done eating, Mine's family stops by to check on her, and we confirm she'll spend one more day with Frida and drop off a bottle of Rincham to thank her with. Lutz stops by right after to say Benno will pop in, and Frida is super jealous that Lutz and Benno get all the attention. Mine notices that and says that she'll swing by his store when she's better. So with that, the two pop off to the kitchen to meet... here comes the first in a long line of butchering. Lise? Frida's family chef, and Mine decides to make a pound cake. This is a bit of a problem since they don't measure things the same way, but the recipe is simple enough to translate since it's equal parts of four ingredients. Plus Mine sees that they have real sugar, which is for the super rich. Frida and Mine help, with massive air quotes, but Lise does most of the work, and it turns out decently well. With some adjustments to baking, it would even be perfect. So mission accomplished, and the two girls go out to bathe while Lise tries again to perfect the pound cake. You know, it's not like introducing things on a whim has ever backfired before on her, right? So Mine follows Frida into their basement, where they have an actual full-on noble-style bathhouse. Of course. She shows Frida how to use the Rinsham, and Mine gets a soak too. There she learns that Frida is living a lavish lifestyle because, well, she's a rich girl and can afford it, but also because she has no autonomy in her life. Gustav modeled both his home and Frida's upbringing after his noble clients. That way she was prepared for her life away from her family. She was groomed from an early age to be this link to nobility to earn more money, and all this lavish stuff is just to get her used to that lifestyle. The constant bathing, manners, and grace that she exudes is all a product of that. And yeah, it might seem weird, but Frida's just accepted it. Mine also understands that's probably why she's latching on to her, because she has no friends or real life outside of what's already been decided for her. She was sick with the devouring growing up, and by the time she's an adult, she's gonna be a noble's mistress. Just understand, she had no time to play. She studied her butt off so that she knew everything she could about being a merchant, as well as so she could pass in noble society. That really strikes home when looking at Mine's circumstances later down the line. So Lutz shows up again, gets some pound cake, and tells Mine she looks like hell and to get some sleep. We learn that while Frida may have the devouring, she's not sickly like Mine. Mana eats away at people, affecting their growth, but Mine has an abnormally weak constitution on top of that. Both Frida and Mine are shocked to learn this because Frida assumed Mine was mostly healthy like her, while Mine assumed Frida was weak like she was, leading to Mine doing too much and, well, overdoing it again. So she's sent to bed and passes out. The next day is Frida's big day. Her baptism is finally here, kicking off winter, and dinner the previous night was extra exciting, mostly due to Mine's pound cake. So now the guildmaster's entire family wishes to meet her. Sensing the danger already, Mine decides to eat in her room since Gustav and Frida were scary enough, so the whole family would mean certain doom for her naive ass. But Frida's attendant rushes in and asks Mine if she can put Frida's hairpin on, since she doesn't know how. Mine accepts, but this is a bit of a trap, you see. After they get Frida all dressed up, her family comes in heaping praise on her for looking so damn cute, and we're introduced to her brothers, who are a little less reliable for a promise between family members. As Frida's whole family sees her, Gustav notices Mine is there, and thanks her once again for the advice about a happy smile over a surprised look. But he's yanked back as the whole family swarms Mine. She meets her father, mother, and two brothers in quick succession before being dragged down to the baptism. But Frida steps in to protect her at the last second. After everyone leaves and Mime watches the procession of kids start, she realizes how much she misses her family. At noon, her family arrives and they take her home, after respectfully declining the invitation for lunch, that is. It's here that Mine expresses how her little poor apartment had become her actual home in the last year. She really just missed the people in it. The next day, after being home, Mine and Lutz go to Benno's to report what happened. Once there, they see his store is bustling, which threw Mine off, as she assumed people shut in and tighten their purse strings for winter. But as it turns out, nobility does the opposite. They actually blow cash like it's going out of style because they're fucking bored. The commoner perspective is so funny in retrospect. But Mine, thinking they're bored, realizes she would like to make some games, but decides to put it off for after their baptism. Lutz wants to know what she thought up, but it's best to save it for when they're actually merchants. Upon seeing her, Benno doubts that she's actually okay, so Lutz reassures him that she was simply lost in thought, which Benno, knowing Mine, accepts. Mine thanks Benno for his help. Benno talks about how hard it was to convince Gustav to even give up a single magic tool, and he half expected him to go back on it anyway. And Mine explains how he was actually tricked by Gustav, since he told Benno a way lower price to get Mine in his debt to switch stores. He reminds Mine to stay on her toes with them, because that family will literally eat each other alive given the chance. It's about this time, reflecting on how well her pound cake went over, Mine asks Benno how common sugar is. And it turns out it's, not common at all, as it's a recent import, meaning mine accidentally introduced a new thing that's exceedingly popular. Wow, who could have seen that coming? So mine says how she invented a new sweet, and Benno and Lutz berate her for going too far, and basically she's giving them free information to now sell. Though to be honest, she's pretty lucky Frida's family is going easy on her, as they could approach her dad, force the issue having saved her life, and have her engaged to one of Frida's brothers before she even knew what was happening. Yeah, this is a reoccurring theme. Status-based societies are pretty fucking scary. She says she'll tell Benno the recipe too if he wants, and Benno reads between the lines saying she knows more than just that. Good eye, Benno. With all that said, they leave, having made plans for when to sell hairpins to him so he'll have stock for spring baptism, and also for Lutz to come over to Mine's house to study over winter. But now that it is winter, it's time for them to get Mine's dress prepared for summer baptism. She'll be wearing the same one that Tuli had, but Mine's too small, so they'll need to make some adjustments. Mine suggests just using the excess cloth to make frills and cover up the seams, but frills and excessive cloth are for rich people, because cloth is fucking expensive. And basically, the more billowy your clothes are, the more money you have. But Effa does like Mine's idea and decides to try it. Mine catches multiple fevers over the course of this because she's standing in a summer outfit in the middle of winter, so yeah. And we also learn that soldiers shovel snow in the city for extra pay. That's what her dad's doing most of the time. Effa works on Mine's dress, Tuli makes a better hairpin, or hairstick rather, by attaching the ornament to her normal hairstick. By the end, Mine's outfit looks crazy fancy, like a rich girl, and completely unlike a soldier's daughter. Sometime later, Lutz knocks on Mine's door, and he's there to do two things: drop off the wooden pin parts, and study. Mine uses this as an excuse to write down stories instead of handiwork, but Effa kills the mood by asking Lutz if he's serious about this whole merchant thing, even if Mine isn't. He affirms that he is, which is enough to make Effa accept him, because all she heard was Carlo's side of the story. You know, all the complaining. From her point of view, Mine just dragged Lutz around, so she assumed Mine was the reason, not Lutz himself. So now that Effa knows that Lutz is for real, she lets him know that he's doing the right thing, because he's in it for himself and not Mine. Lutz asks her why they're so cool with Mine being a merchant if everyone hates them, but Effa says they didn't think Mine could work at all, so they'll support her in pretty much whatever. Yeah, if you think your kid's gonna die at the drop of a hat, you're probably gonna support them in doing anything. With that, they get to studying, and Mine reflects on her own path since she's pursuing this whole merchant thing, but honestly, with how sick she is, she can't actually travel or do much. So she's spending her winter thinking about what Frida told her, as well as deciding what she wants to do. Well, good thing she has plenty of time for that. On a less garbage day, Mine heads to the gatehouse to help Oto, and talk to him about her problem. Gunther runs Mine there, basically throws her at Oto, and he immediately piles on the paperwork. That is, until they're interrupted by a soldier who's looking for what to do about a noble. So, Mine handles it at Oto's order. After all that, though, she finally asks him for some advice. Can she actually handle being a merchant, or should she just quit? The end of the last book showed she really couldn't handle the workload, and this one so far is her confronting that reality. Oto tells her she probably won't be able to keep up since Benno's store is basically blowing up, and she'll just be dead weight. Not to mention Mine's special treatment concerning her health while also the extra pay she'll make from her products will cause some strain internally. Oto asks Mine if she in fact has the devouring, and after she confirms that, he tells her she needs to square that away with her family because they all think she's cured. If she wants to live, she needs to work for the guildmaster to secure better terms from a noble, but Mine replies that she's not sure she wants to live as a noble slave. Basically, she needs to talk things over with her family. So when Gunther comes to get her, the two decide to talk when they get home so everyone can hear, which they do after dinner. All eyes are on Mine as she says her disease can't be cured. Probably because it's not a disease, but just having mana. And commoners die due to their lack of access to tools that can absorb it. But her family's all upset, because they assume that since the guildmaster said she was better, it meant that she was cured. That's, again, not the case. She explains exactly what her condition is and that the only cure is getting a connection to a noble. For a commoner, that means either being their mistress or a slave. Effa's worried about how much it costs to save her life, and Tuli's shocked it was that much, but Gunther's sharp eye pinpoints Mine knows how long she has left. because, she was sidestepping it. So she tells them she only has a year at best. For two books in a row, we get a really touching scene where Mine basically pours out her emotions for her family, saying she would rather die than live away from them, being taken by a noble. So she's resolved to spend what little time she has left, living there with them and being as happy as possible. The next big part of their talk is what to do for her life post-baptism, since, you know, she'll have about 6 months or so after that. She can't really work for Benno because that's fucking hard. So her family tells her to just say to him that she can't work there due to her health. They then decide to call it a night, but Mine wakes up after bed and sees her dad is still up. She sneaks out of bed and, through a crack in the door, finds that he's drinking, quietly crying to himself.
Damn, this just really hits so hard because the man's staring the impending death of his kid in the face. Anyone can sympathize with that, but you have to understand, Gunther is a happy, family-loving, goofy sort of guy. The audience likes him, but subsequent rereads of this book, it just makes it hit even harder, like, damn, Gunther's losing another one.
A bit later, Mine's back at the gate while everyone's out gathering perus. They're acting like everything's normal, but Tuli's more protective and Gunther's putting on a brave face. She thanks Oto for his advice and says he'll throw some work her way after her baptism if she asks. Which gets Mine thinking that things really don't have to change. She's bringing in the cash pretty nicely so she can just do what she does. She goes on over to Lutz's house and tells him, and he's surprised, but understands after getting the whole host of problems it would cause. Carla is listening in and tells Lutz now he doesn't have to be a merchant, and Lutz finally goes off on her saying he's not doing it for Mine, but because he wants to. Having her ear finally, he tells her all he's been through to get to where he is. And she actually gets it. She understands how crappy his brothers are to him by stealing his food and literally his stuff, so Carla is actually in his corner now, willing to help protect him from his brothers. Good for him. Spring is slowly setting in, so Mine and Lutz go to Benno's to cash in on their handiwork. They meet Mark and he gives them a weird greeting about melting snow and blessing of the goddess of spring and such, which Lutz and Mine are confused. And strangely, Mark is confused that they're confused, because as far as he knew, it was a common greeting. Don't worry, Mark. They get more complicated as the series goes on.
May I pray for a blessing and appreciation of this serendipitous meeting ordained by the harsh judgment of Wigelia, the god of life. Rolls right off the tongue, doesn't it?
Benno is busy, so Mark deals with the kids, buying pins, confirming the completion of the large Zucchetta, and Mine's last business is about her apprenticeship, so that needs to be discussed with the big man himself. His meeting ends, and Mine rushes up to try her new greeting, only to flub her line and get a laugh. Mine's immediate reply after that is she's not going to be his apprentice. And, Benno's sort of floored by that. I mean, he just laughed, really? She explains that she's weak and it isn't fair to the other apprentices, and Benno sees where she's coming from there. She says not much will change from what she's doing already, but her guild card is registered to Benno, and that could be a problem if she doesn't work for him. He says they'll turn her into the forewoman of the mine workshop, that, being the storage shed they use, and quite literally, not much will change. It's decided that Lutz will show Benno how to make paper, so they can ramp up for mass production. Speaking of, Mine and Lutz go back to the workshop to check on the trombe bark they left there before winter, and it's fine, so they pick up where they left off with it. The next day, Lutz and Mine are actually there checking on the Volrin white bark and trombe black bark, which turns out it doesn't get moldy even after months of being left out. Trombe paper is really stacking up in the document durability department, being mold and fire resistant. I wonder if that'll impact the price. They then go to gather where Mine learns more about foraging. She sees Lutz avoiding these little red fruits and asks about them, but they're called tau fruit, which is just a thin membrane filled with water that swells up at the end of summer. Also, they pop when thrown at somebody, which is fun. So, nature's water balloon, as Mine puts it. This is actually introducing some world building, with a ceremony called the Star Festival where commoners throw tau at newlyweds as a bit of playful spite. Mine doesn't remember this happening at all, but she was on Death's Door right before meeting Benno the first time when the ceremony happened last summer. So, she missed it. The next day, they were swishing some pulp for some Volrin paper in the large Zucchetta, when Mine decides to split the finished product so that she can keep some paper to make a book, without affecting Lutz's bottom line. They're having fewer screw-ups, so Mine's not getting as much paper to make a book out of. They go to sell the finished paper, and Benno comments on Mine's haul being less. And she says she wants to keep some, which should be fine since it's wood they foraged.
and Benno says it is, but he wants to know why she's keeping it. She says she wants to make a book, and Benno laughs it off because books don't sell. Which is fine with her, she says she doesn't want to sell it anyway. After that, Benno gives up on trying to understand her because it's a waste of brain power and just buys their paper. Since they're selling contract-sized paper, not postcard-size, these sell for a large silver each, and Benno takes his 30% fee, meaning mine and Lutz are getting 7 small silvers per sheet. But that's not all. Since Lutz is selling 13, he's walking home with 9 large silvers and a small silver. The boy damn near made a small gold coin that day, which is like damn near a year's salary for some people. Lutz is spooked by that large sum, and Benno jokes about upping his fee if he's scared, but mine suggests lowering the price, which Benno shoots down because they can't or else they'd piss off the vested interest, as they're referred to in this chapter, which is basically the Parchment Guild, craftsmen who tan and treat the hides, and people who raise livestock for papermaking. Yeah, they don't want to piss them off. Yet. The next day, Lutz brings ponchos and a letter of invitation from Benno, saying some people are pissed off about the paper they're making, so Lutz and mine need to wear ponchos to not stand out too much by, giving away their poor upbringing. So they need to take those to go buy clothes with Mark. Mine picks up that those vested interests Benno hinted at are already bearing down hard. Mine explains Ecom 101 to Lutz with supply and demand because he's confused why they're upset, and mine says that they're pushing a new product that's faster to produce, less labor intensive, and eventually cheaper, onto the market, making less room for Parchment to profit. Even Lutz gets them being pissed off about that, hence why they're wearing ponchos to go buy clothes that fit in with the richer part of the lower city. So they meet Mark, he takes Lutz and mine to go get their Gilberta Company apprentice outfits, because mine will be coming by often and she needs to stand out less. And they head back to meet Benno. Benno immediately tells them they moved too fast, and it pissed off the Parchment Guild, who complained to the Merchants Guild about unlawful paper being sold. Mine's worried, but Benno's confident. Their paper is, made from wood, not animal hide. So it has nothing to do with their guild, so he told them to buzz off. Mine's first instinct here is to compromise, and suggest contracts be made exclusively on parchment instead of plant paper. But Benno calls her soft and says they're not backing down. The difference is goals, as mine wants paper to be widely available to the point that kids don't even have to worry about paying for it, while Benno is concerned with securing a profit. This does introduce the idea of different papers being used for different purposes, which Benno points out saying he plans Trombe paper to be more expensive because it's fire resistant. The contract size paper they're making out of it? Benno's looking at 5 large silvers per sheet. So with that much profit on the line and friction in the market from conflicting power bases, he wants to keep the kids hidden for a while, at least until the Parchment Guild business settles down. The big takeaway Benno leaves mine with is that people could literally die from this, because ignorance isn't an excuse when breaking magic contracts. She's upset hearing that, and it torments her during this waiting process. In the meantime, Lutz forces mine to the woods to make paper, but Benno doesn't contact them after several days, probably weeks. But no word has spread about a suspicious death or anything, and eventually Mine calls Benno's trustworthiness into question. After all, what sort of contract kills somebody who doesn't know any better? But Lutz says it makes sense to him because he doesn't fucking know it's magic. Mine is basically skeptical, because what if someone signed a contract for an existing product? Or there was another contract in a city far away that they didn't know about? And good point, as far as she knows, those two things could happen, and it would make no sense. But as she and Lutz are discussing this, Oto pops up and says he's got word from the man himself. Seems everything's over. That's it. Anticlimactic as that is, Mine is pressing for more, but Oto just doesn't have anything more to tell. Though at least he does put her at ease, saying no one's hurt from their contract. So he offers to take the kids to see Benno now that the whole thing's settled and they can talk to him about it. Well, once they finish, that is. And, Oto's there, seeing the Suketa sifting phase up close, and keeps asking questions. Questions Mine's not answering, so she doesn't get yelled at by Benno. So Oto carries Mine into Benno's office and tells him his goddess of water has arrived. And that's an inappropriate double entendre in this world. But Benno's having none of it and tells him to keep his shitty jokes to himself. Oto deflects, throwing Mine under the bus, saying she was complaining about not trusting Benno. And Benno sighs because he just worked his ass off to keep the kids safe. So, while they're there, he answers their questions. The magic contract they signed has the potential to hurt people uninvolved. So that means two things as far as Mine's fears are concerned. Magic contracts, excluding ones between nobles, don't extend out of the city's magic barrier built into the city walls as part of the foundation. And that's a vague concept that's sparsely touched on after about 15 volumes that's first mentioned here. But most important is this was reported to the Archduke himself, since it involved potentially hurting others. And also to the Merchant Guild, since it was a new product. Benno also put in to create a new plant paper guild while he was there. Yeah, he was always going to fight this head on. But Gustav blocked Benno's attempt at a guild at first, due to the fact that there wasn't a prototype when he first applied. And, when he had one, there was already a paper-making guild. Since he dragged his feet, that got the Parchment Guild up in arms, thinking there was a breach, when in reality, Benno was going through the proper channels all along. So his real enemy here was Gustav. Again. Yeah, it was basically a scheme to knock Benno down. But the Parchment Guild agreed to the compromise of letting different paper be used for different things, forcing Gustav's hand, and Benno ripped him hard at the meeting, which only made the two hate each other more. So with everything settled, it's time for Mine and Lutz to tell Benno how to make paper. Mine isn't seeing a profit from all this though, so she tells Benno she wants an information fee again, and he happily accepts. Yeah, whatever she wants, he'll pay it. That's a red flag. So she says twice as much as last time, and Benno forks over 6 small gold coins with a big grin. Mine still doesn't know what stuff's worth in this world. But it comes down to all the stuff they currently have to make paper isn't gonna work for mass production. So they convince Benno he'll need to stop by and see the process, so Mine can explain what parts are inefficient and how he can scale them up. Which Benno does come and see, and he watches Lutz carry the heavy crap as they go out to the forest. They bump into Oto and Gunther at the gate and get some flack because Benno looks like Mine's dad carrying her and all, but Benno shuts that all down by saying he's a forever bachelor. Mine asks why, and it turns out his crush died when he was young. Benno could never see himself loving again after that. He talks a bit about his childhood friend, how he used to sneak off to the forest and spend his free time as an apprentice. Once at the river, Benno tells Lutz he needs to start calling him Master Benno since he'll be his apprentice soon, and to keep clean when visiting his store. Besides that, he sticks to Lutz to see what wood to gather. When they get back, he notices Mine not doing anything at all, and she explains that she causes more problems by helping due to her health. Mine talks up Lutz during this process, which makes him run off to go gather more, and when he gets back, they start steaming. They introduce steamed potatoes. Hey, they called it that in the book, so I don't have to struggle pronouncing fantasy words anymore. And then dunk the wood to peel the bark. With that, they head back, put it up to dry, and Mine explains the rest of the process to Benno by showing him the tools. He asks questions, and Mine points out where bigger tools would work better. After Benno gets a grasp on it, it comes down to Mine and Lutz to go around with Mark to workshops ordering tools for mass production, while Benno secures a workshop to make paper in. They trained the craftsmen, got the tools, and were ready by the time spring turned into summer. On a particularly cloudy day, Lutz asks Mine what she's gonna do, since their baptism is around the corner, it's a shitty day to make paper, and the paper workshop for Benno is pretty much done. She doesn't know, but they lament not being able to make more paper because they want more cash. And we learn that Mine has saved over 2 large gold coins in the bank, which is like damn near 18 years of her father's salary. But Mine remembers that neither of them know what tools Lutz will need to be an apprentice merchant. Remember back when Tule became an apprentice? She was given work clothes and a sewing kit as a present? But Lutz's parents aren't merchants and don't know what he'll need. Besides, his dad is still against him being a merchant anyway. So they visit Benno and he tells them to go with Mark because their work clothes are done, and also to order more uniforms because Lutz is gonna need multiple. So they pick up their finished uniforms and Mine is pleased, because she looks like the daughter of a rich family wearing new clothes. Well, as long as she keeps her mouth shut at least. They pick up some stationery, pen, ink, piece of parchment, as well as some wooden boards, which means had Lutz not been saving his money, he'd be SOL. Because his parents can't afford this stuff. Mine buys her own ink and pen too, because she's just happy to be able to afford it finally. When they meet with Benno again, he takes them to the guild to show them how to do paperwork. While learning, Mine gets called to by Frida, now wearing the Othmar Company apprentice outfit. She's a little upset Mine hasn't visited, but they can rectify that with an invitation. Benno tries to stop Mine, but they agree that if it rains, Mine will go to Frida's to talk about the devouring and hang out. Benno's extra annoyed because Mine didn't realize that it would rain. Yeah, the dark clouds hanging over the city basically confirm that, even without a weather report. Sure enough, it does rain. So Mine is planning to go to Frida's with Lutz while Tule is at work, but she's upset because she couldn't prepare a gift in time. Benno doesn't want her giving out Rinsham for free anymore, since he's selling it now, and she has nothing else to give. Well, recipes, I guess. But she'd rather keep those to sell at a later date. Before Tuli actually heads out, there's a knock which they assume is Lutz, but it's actually Frida. She looks super out of place, being so damn obviously rich because of her clothes in a poor section of town, and offers to give Mine a ride to her house in a carriage. Tuli is super jealous of this, and Frida snags an opportunity to take Tuli to work so she can avoid taking Lutz. Mine isn't exactly happy about that underhandedness, but accepts because she's already walked into Frida's trap as of yesterday. So they drop a positively ecstatic Tuli off at work, because commoners could go their whole lives without riding in a carriage once. They go off to Frida's house, where Lise is waiting to tap Mine for ideas for pound cake. Mine trades her knowledge for a bag of sugar, suggests dried fruit and nuts while topping it with whipped cream. Lise immediately rushes to go test these out while Frida gets to the point. She wants to know why Mine isn't joining the Othmar company and ditching Benno. Mine lays it out that she's basically accepted her fate, and living as a slave isn't for her. I mean, sure, nobles have books, but books she won't get to read because they won't let a grubby commoner touch them even as a slave. So Mine'll stick with what's making her happy, her family. There's nothing else they could do, so Mine can't buy magic tools, and since making one requires mana, no one in the lower city can make them, which means she can't figure out how to make one herself to survive. So since she has no other options left, she'll just die. But before she does, she wants to make as much money as she can to leave behind for her family. Frida offers to buy the pound cake rights from Mine for exclusive distribution, and Mine agrees on a temporary basis. She asks if Frida would do it for 5 small gold coins, like she got from Benno before, and she agrees immediately. Turns out Benno was screwing Mine hard on rights negotiations. As Frida explains, new products typically go in the range of large gold coins and not smalls, as there's nothing to compare and they'll make that back and then some with sales. Mine signs a contract and learns that most contracts between commoners aren't of the magical variety, which makes Frida ask how she even knows about those. And Mine finally learns to shut her mouth for once after imagining the invisible hand of Benno smacking her head. Mine is also planning on pound cake spreading after that year is up so others can improve on it. But Frida isn't planning on telling anyone how it's made, so Mine's gonna have to survive for another year at least to publish it. Yeah, this is Frida in her own way telling Mine to live on. It's finally time for the baptism, so Mine gets ready, and it turns out she grew a little bit since they made her dress. Good for her. Once outside, everyone fusses over how cute she looks, and that prevents Mine from talking to Lutz, which sucks because he's clearly surprised by how good she looked. Gunther carries her off to the ceremony in the crowd where everyone's waving at her, and Mine sees just how much support she has from everyone at Benno's store and Frida, as well as the Guildmaster's entire family right as they get to the temple. Once there, Mine is set down because Gunther can't go any further, and Lutz walks her in the rest of the way. Just as they get past these huge wooden doors though, he says to her that she looks really cute today, and that makes her blush. Also, Gunther wants to kill him because everyone's talking about how cute they look, and walking into the temple holding hands makes them look like they're getting married. Yeah, overprotective dad mode just kicked in. Inside the temple, they see some priests. Some are wearing gray robes while some are wearing blue. One blue-robed priest steps in front of the door right as it closes and rings a bell with a stone on it, and that makes it so the kids can't talk above a whisper, meaning he has a magic tool right there. As they walk further in, we see statues of the gods of this world holding certain items that are their divine instruments, which are incredibly important moving forward, but not quite at this point in the story, so forgive me for glossing over them for now. Get ready for all that in part 2. Mine and Lutz wait in line to get their fingers pricked, and then they press their blood onto a small silver plate, and that's their citizenship right there. From there, they're guided to some mats by a gray-robed priest.
In the anime, the priest handling the citizenship was the high priest, but here in the book, we don't get a description of him. It's just a blue-robed priest.
Once seated, the high bishop enters, a Santa-looking motherfucker with a white robe carrying a jewel-encrusted book. He reads a passage from it, which turns out to be the Bible of that world. And Mine's super into it because she's getting a creation myth right here. We learn that the god of darkness and the god of light married and had some kids. The god of fire, water, wind, and earth. The god of earth married the god of life, but he's a jealous prick who froze her in ice. That weakened him when the other gods found out about it. They kicked his ass, with water washing both him and the ice away, letting seeds grow. Fire lends his power, letting the plant seeds sprout,
But this also gives the God of Life his power back, which is where the God of Wind steps in to try and keep his ass at bay. But he wins out against the weakened gods and froze Earth again. That's the seasons right there, meaning mine and Lutz were born under the God of Fire. And that fits her to a T, being hot-blooded, passionate, and good at teaching others. Now that the deep lore is out of the way, the High Bishop teaches the kids to pray. Which is just the silliest shit mine's ever seen, because it looks just like the Glycoman pose. She cracks up laughing so hard she collapses, but doesn't quite pass out. She's taken to the rich people medical room because her clothes are so fancy looking, and after she recovers a bit, she realizes she needs to use the bathroom, and yeah, there's a chamber pot, but no water. So she has to go look for someone to help her. Thus she sneaks out of the room and makes a wrong turn into the noble section of the temple. Having realized she fucked up, Mine tries to get back to safety, only to be found by a shrine maiden wearing a gray robe. She explains the situation and the shrine maiden says she'll help her out, but she has to finish something first. Mine sees that the woman went into a room filled with books and she loses her damn mind. She tries to run in but hits a barrier of some sort and starts bawling her eyes out. The shrine maiden asks what she's doing and Mine says that she wants to go inside and read. But to do that, she needs to work there and have special permission. So Mine asks how to get that, and she learns that she needs permission from the High Priest or High Bishop. Which, of course, means Mine's gonna beg this Shrine Maiden to take her to the High Bishop so that she can ask for permission. She just doesn't learn, does she? Once there, she meets with him, and he's surprised anyone would want to be a Shrine Maiden willingly. Mine explains that she wants to read, but the Bishop brushes her off, saying people there serve the gods, not just read. Mine explains that the Bible itself is her god, that she really wants to dedicate herself to reading and learning more about those gods contained within, and he should believe her passion as someone blessed by the God of Fire. He tells her someone of her family status will need a donation to match her passion, basically saying pay up to join the temple, and Mine says she'll pay a whole large gold coin to join on her own. He damn near falls out of his chair over that, but tells her she'll have to lose all other affiliations she has to join. She's in the Merchants Guild and hasn't talked to her parents about it, so the High Bishop tells her to ask them and return with an answer. And when she comes back, she can read the Bible with him. Mine, overfilled with joy, praises the gods in earnest, striking a beautiful Glycoman pose, only to collapse in front of the High Bishop. She's carried back to the medical room and the gray shrine maiden waits there with her, meaning Mine has to use the bathroom and the woman has to clean up after her, which makes Mine want to die. But before she can, Lutz shows up and asks what the hell happened. Mine tries to cover up her mistake, but we're 3 volumes in now. He knows her too well to fall for that. So he asks, what the hell did she do? He calls her an idiot when she admits that she wandered into the noble section of the temple, but when she tries to leave it at that, the shrine maiden in there with them says that she barged into the High Bishop's room to ask to use the book room, and Lutz calls her a fucking moron. Before she can do any more damage, he carries her out and hands her over to her dad. They go to Benno's on the way back so Lutz can sign his contract to work there, but Mine doesn't go inside with him because she's feeling like shit. Once home, Mine decides to spring it on her family after their fancy dinner that she wants to be an apprentice shrine maiden, and her dad becomes unhinged. Furious, he tells her that it's out of the question because people who go to work at the temple are orphans, with no other options for work, and that's why the High Bishop was in disbelief that someone wanted to willingly become a shrine maiden. Effa calms Gunther down and asks why Mine wanted to be one. Mine explains what happened at the temple, that she found a book room, and that she wants to read those books. Her dad tells her to give up on them and just make her own like she has been, because if she becomes an apprentice shrine maiden, she can't see her family anymore. And that was the whole reason she didn't sign with a noble in the first place. After her family guilt trips her about trying to break her promise and leave, she says she'll tell the High Bishop she's changed her mind when she feels better. But her devouring heat is starting to act up already due to the 2 minds she has. One, wanting to stay with her family that makes her happy, and two, go read books like she's been wanting to do since she became Mine. Remember, she needs a definitive goal here to keep that in check. So when the heat finally goes down, Lutz checks on her, and they make plans to go to Benno's. Lutz also calls her an idiot again for not thinking, and Mine remarks how he's matured. Mine and Lutz go to the temple the next day, where Mine goes in alone. There she's escorted to the High Bishop's room, but instead meets another man, the High Priest. He's a cold, logical stud who will be playing an incredibly important role for the rest of this story. He reads Mine the Bible, but she's across the table from him and asks if she can read it herself. He's confused because he thought she wanted to learn more about the gods, but she says that she wants to read it herself and learn new words, The High Priest allows her to sit on his lap as long as she doesn't touch it so that she can read along with him. This is pretty much all Mai never wanted to do in this world, so she's pretty much in heaven. When the High Bishop comes in, he asks how it went convincing her parents, and she says they won't let her because only orphans can join the temple. The High Priest interjects, saying that's not necessarily true, the temple just takes those who cannot work elsewhere, which is almost exclusively orphans. Mine also says that she can't do the physical labor demanded of them because she's sickly, and that surprises the High Bishop, as she's sickly in general and passing out wasn't just a one-time thing. She says she has the devouring and the mood changes suddenly. The High Bishop tells the High Priest to go fetch the thing, which he's already in the process of doing, and Mine is sort of left to assume that she's stuck there while the High Bishop prays. They bring her one of the items on display from the baptism ceremony, a gold chalice, and instruct her to touch it. When she does, it glows, making Mine wince, and they immediately give her an invitation for her parents to come to the temple in 2 days. And we all know what that means by now. After that, Mine's basically stuck waiting for Lutz to pick her up, and the High Priest offers to keep reading her the Bible until he comes. When he finally does, Mine leaps at the chance, and Lutz, quite literally, for some comfort and explains what happened. He's a bit at a loss, because she left out a key piece of information about wanting to become a shrine maiden in the first place. But he says Benno wants to see her and hear all about it. He has a million questions, so when they arrive, he has Mine explain it all to him firsthand, where he finds out she made about a billion mistakes that could have cost her her life. But now that he understands the situation, he lays it out for her. Mine's about to be snatched up by the nobility because she's a kid with mana, has a bunch of ideas worth a fortune, and she's rich herself. She needs to quit talking about how she doesn't want to be treated as a slave and start putting forward a plan to avoid being treated as such. All for preparations for when she does get pulled in by the nobility. This was all mentioned before about how nice the guildmaster was being by not forcing Mine into marrying one of his family members to secure her for his store, but nobility doesn't even have to go to those lengths. So Benno instructs her on what she needs to do, and they get to work immediately. First, make a magic contract with Lutz and Benno, so that Lutz is the only person who can sell her inventions. Why? Because that way when she's taken, Lutz can be the intermediary to communicate with her family in the lower city. Second, register her as the foreman of the mine workshop so that she can prove her worth as a revenue stream. This will help her fight back with money. A few things to note, blue robe priests and shrine maidens are not nobles, but of that class. So they're higher ranked in the temple and are served by the gray robes because those are commoner orphans. When nobles don't like a kid's low mana capacity, they're sent to the temple, or when they can't afford a magic tool for them to survive. And with Benno's intel about how the central part of the nation, the sovereignty, had a massive civil war that saw a huge purge of nobles, the temples are having blue robes leave en masse to rejoin noble society. Meaning, there's a void there that needs to be filled. This hurts the duchy as a whole too, because the mana of the blue robes is used in rituals to promote crop growth. Plus, they have magic tools at the temple, meaning Mine can actually survive there. So Mine has a golden opportunity at the moment. They're low on mana and low on money, which are two things she has, so she can negotiate herself some good terms, like being treated as a blue robe despite her commoner heritage. So Benno drags Mine to the guild to register as a forewoman post-haste, and she meets Frida there who wants to spend time with her and she tries to set up a date. Too bad Mine's busy, and she instead gives Frida the idea to hold a taste testing event for her new pound cakes. She rushes off to go plan this event having been successfully diverted, and Mine and Lutz can finally go home after a long as hell day. We get a heartfelt scene here, where Lutz is basically crying over Mine getting taken away, and she reassures him that they still have that connection with their magic contract cemented. When Mine gets home, she pushes right past her family looking for answers, especially since she's so late, just so that she can eat dinner because she's starving. When she's done, she tells them a few things. Karina was quite taken by the outfit and hairpin Mine had at her baptism, and wants to meet Mine to learn about it, but it's not an official invitation, so they could probably take Tuli and Effa too since they're the ones who did most of the work. But the real meat of this discussion here is Mine found out that her devouring is actually mana, and her mana is needed by the temple. So if they leverage that and her money, she could possibly be treated as a blue robe. Her mom and dad are scared for her and promise to protect her, which makes Mine happy, because she was worried that they'd be scared that she has mana, just like nobles. Once the High Bishop sees Mine's parents, his jolly grandpa demeanor changes, and he asks what they do for a living. Mine says that her dad's a soldier and her mom's a dyer. He scoffs and tells them to hand Mine over, but her parents refuse immediately, forcing the High Bishop to use violence. He orders the Grey Priest to lock up Mine, but her dad fights them off.
I just gotta point this out, the Grey Robe Priests are not fighters. Like, they're told from birth that violence is never okay because they're raised to be a servant class. Teaching them violence is going to cause an uprising. That's bad. So seeing them try to ineptly hold Gunther is pretty funny.
Finally having enough, Mine loses her temper, and the High Bishop practically crumples under her sight. Now, her body is insanely hot, but her mind is super calm right now, which is a situation we've seen before when her clay tablets are squashed in the forest. Mine thinks the High Bishop is just pathetic, getting so scared over a little girl, and that shows how weak he actually is. But the High Priest tells her to control her mana because she could actually kill him with her crushing. That's basically when someone lets their emotions get out of control and they hit an enemy with waves of raw mana, bludgeoning them with it, and it can be fatal if someone's strong enough. Mine is so strong that it makes the High Priest bleed from his mouth when she looks at him, but he says that he's willing to listen to her. When she calms down, the High Priest orders the other priest to get the bishop into bed, and also to rest themselves because they got hit too. They're also commoners, so it hit them pretty fucking hard. They go to the High Priest's room to finish their discussion, and Mine can see that he's pretty exhausted too from that crushing. So Mine's parents lay out their demands. They know that the nobility are hurting financially and magically, so they've got the upper hand. To which the High Priest wonders aloud just how much she knows about their situation, before allowing them to list their wants. Mine needs to be treated as a blue robe shrine maiden, and the priest says that that was their intention all along. Well, before the bishop's outburst, that is. That she needs someone to look after her health, which the priest interprets as servants, and it's common for blue robes to have several, so that's not a problem. They also want Mine to commute from home, because she can get sick so easily. The priest says that since she has a home, it's not really a problem for her to come when she's healthy to do her duties, which are magic tool upkeep and, Mine's favorite, bookroom keeping. That's pretty much all she wanted out of this deal, so she thinks the High Priest is a pretty nice guy.
Whether he's nice or not is a complicated issue and just laughably wishful thinking compared to Mine later on.
As for her workshop, it's a bit more complicated, but he's not initially opposed, and says that they will need to discuss this at a later date. With all their demands met, it's their victory, and they call the meeting to a close. Mine will come back to the temple in 1 month to start her new job as an apprentice blue robe shrine maiden. The almost whole family goes home, meeting up with the last member outside, where Mine proudly declares, she's home. In the epilogue, we see Gunther having to listen to a gloating Oto about his new baby on the way, while he also tells Gunther about some of the behind-the-scenes stuff that's been going on. Oto will be taking over the Gilberta company in the coming years, so Benno can branch out and make his own new store, since the products Mine's bringing in are out of the Gilberta company's repertoire. That was hinted at in Corina's side story, and it's finally elaborated on here. Gunther is sort of skeptical about how much Mine is bringing in, but Oto confirms it for him, and hints that she's blessed by the gods because she's so stupid good at managing her money, and no one's taught her how to. He also relays some more important info. Since Benno took measures to secure Mine's safety in the city, and Gunther is feeling worthless, he actually has the most important job of all. He needs to use his connections as a soldier to watch the walls, and make sure an outside noble doesn't slip in to steal Mine as she becomes more influential with her goods. It's up to them to protect the city, and since Benno stuck his neck out so much for Mine, both of their families as well.
So we finally hit the end. Or not. You see, the last volume in a part contains the most side stories, and this one's packing 6. Weirdly enough, Mine's a pretty active participant in most of these, which is new to the franchise to this point, where most were just looking at her actions after the fact, with characters reflecting on them. Also, the side stories in this one take place after the main events, and damn near sequentially. So let's look at Tuli visiting Corina first.
This is, you guessed it, about Tuli and Effa visiting Corina's place with Mine, so she can show her her baptism dress, as well as the hair stick with the ornament. It was mentioned before that she wanted to see them, so Mine is making good on it here. We learn that Tuli got to guide someone at her shop, which is a big deal for her, due to her being more clean than her co-workers, which is good for upward mobility. Effa and Tuli get a small crash course on greeting someone like Corina from Mine, and Tuli realizes Mine is pretty much at home in the better part of the city due to her going there so often. Meanwhile, she's self-conscious because she realizes that she stands out. When they get there, they see all the cloth and are in awe, and Tuli is curious how to get that good, to which Mine tells her to observe fashion more, especially in the rich part of the city, plus she should probably practice. They show Karina and go over the dress, which Karina is impressed by. But when it comes to the hairpin, Karina basically cements why she's the true heir to the Gilberta company by asking if she can make them in her workshop, but Mine speaks up and says that she can for a price. That shocks Tuli and Effa because she's being so rude, but Mine explains that they make those for winter handiwork, and that'll be a big hit to them financially. So Karina calls Benno upstairs for business discussions, and that's Effa and Tuli meeting him for the first time. Tuli thinks he looks nice, but is quickly stunned by how Mine can jump into business negotiations with Benno on equal footing. When their discussion gets heated, Karina takes Tuli and Effa to a different table to go over sewing, well, teaching Tuli a bit, but after a while, Mine finally joins them and she's victorious. Karina congratulates her on getting so much out of her brother, but Mine doesn't want to say how much she made because it's too much for her family to comprehend. Finally, Tuli convinces her, and she says she sold it for 1 large gold and 6 smalls. Effa and Tuli are in complete shock, and Tuli is left with the thought that maybe Mine should have been a merchant after all. Next, we have Lise's confectionery recipe, taking place shortly before the pound cake tasting, which Mine pitched to Frida during the book proper. We get some nice backstory with an incredibly minor character in this chapter, which fleshes out Frida and Gustav quite a bit. We learn that she's the daughter of a restaurant owner who worked as a chef and various others until getting scouted to work for a noble. She couldn't make head chef there despite having the talent due to her lack of connections in the kitchen, but when the guildmaster came calling, the head chef she was under recommended her because he recognized her talents. Lise was scouted in an effort to get Frida used to noble life, which means the guildmaster's menu is pretty much that of a lay noble. But Lise is more interested in Mine's sweets knowledge because sugar is a new thing, and most chefs are struggling to incorporate it into their menu besides as a generic sweetener. But Mine gave a recipe that incorporated it so well, like she knew it from heart rather than experimenting. So Lise is excited to get more from her, as mastering recipes is her hobby. Mine shows up with Frida, and Lise is listening in as they talk about how to market pound cake. Mine accidentally lets some ideas slip for free, like seasonal flavors, before accidentally mentioning rum toffs, some sugar and wine-soaked fermented fruits, which Frida immediately pays for the method of. And after Frida leaves, Lise butters Mine up for more ideas with a bag of sugar. So Mine tells her about tea leaf pound cake. Lise proves how perceptive she is by noticing that Mine didn't eat soup at their house, and asks her if she has a way to improve soup. But Mine, finally learning a bit, refuses to give that one up just yet. Finally, she breaks down and asks Mine who exactly she is because she knows things she shouldn't. And Mine replies with what will become a standard reply from her from now on by saying she learned all this stuff in her dreams. Next is Benno pound cake sampling, where we're in Benno's point of view as he's pressured to go to the pound cake tasting held at the guild hall by the guild master. He goes and laments Mine leaking information, but at least she's kept mostly under wraps due to his hard work. No one knows that she's the one inventing all this stuff. He sees Mine at the event helping out and immediately tells her to go get changed, so she doesn't out herself as the inventor. Lutz says Benno is hard on her, but Benno says he needs to protect Mine because she doesn't think before acting. Benno asks Lutz on his impression of the pound cake as a product, and Lutz says he thinks nobles will like it. Benno asks for his reasoning to know that he's not assuming, and Lutz says that these were made by a chef who cooked for nobles, and if Frida and the chef are confident, they'll sell for sure. So Benno learns to not underestimate the information network of kids blabbing. Mine walks Benno through the cakes, and when he tries them, he's blown away by how good they are, but keeps a straight face while Mine pesters him for an opinion. Finally, he asks why she gave the recipe to the guildmaster through Frida, and Mine asks why he hates the guildmaster so much. Turns out he's just been a massive dick to Benno, first by proposing to marry his mom right after his dad died, second offering Benno to marry one of his daughters right after his fiancée died, and third pestering Karina to marry one of his sons. Benno thinks this was because his store was growing, and the guildmaster was trying to crush it, or just flat out absorb it. Mine replies that she thinks Gustav must think highly of the Gilberta company, if he keeps trying to involve himself with it. But Benno's finally had enough, he wants to buy some recipes to compete with Frida. But Frida and Lise step up, and Benno is confronted by the chef who's pissed off Benno's keeping all those recipes from her. Benno declares that he's gonna train a chef to make Mine's recipes, that way he can buy them too. Now we have Mark, the master, and I, from Mark's perspective. We see some backstory with him, as he used to be the son of a merchant working at the Gilberta company for experience, with plans to return to his family store. However, his father died, and his brother handled business so differently he took forever to sign a Laharl contract. That's basically a full-time contract versus the Lahange part-time thing, So he was already an adult and getting a late start on life. Benno's dad died, and when all the other people abandoned ship, Mark asked his family to help by sending people to work at the Gilberta Company because they'd been so good to him, but they flat out refused. Pissed off, he swore to protect the Gilberta Company and Benno. When Benno gets back from the taste test, he calls Mark into his office with Mine and Lutz to sort out the new food selling venture. We learn the Gilberta Company was founded by a wife who made clothes and the husband sold them, so they're venturing further and further outside their scope, hence why Karina doesn't want to sell paper, and is also the true heir to the company. Mine and Benno get into it because Benno wants to make sweets, but lacks an oven and chef to do so, which is why he plans to train a baker and have them make bread in the meantime. Which, Mine is like, that's gonna cause issues with the Baker's Guild for no reason. Mark gets the whole story from Lutz while those two argue, and asks Benno how he plans to execute this, which Benno does have a real plan. But the problem is, them going outside their lane is gonna cause issues. So Mine says, why not make an Italian restaurant, and essentially sells Benno on that idea instead, as it would be easier to register a high-end restaurant without invoking their clout as a big store. After that's decided, Lutz and Mine leave, where Benno brings up that he wants to adopt Lutz. Mark wants to know why he's planning on picking a fight with a pregnant Karina over inheritance with an adopted son, as that's gonna imply that Lutz is going to inherit the store. Benno says he wants to branch out from the Gilberta Company and make his own, with paper at its core. He'll leave the Gilberta Company to Otto and Karina, and he's doing all of this just to secure a stronger connection to Mine. Benno asks Mark, what does he plan to do? And Mark says, he thinks another Laharl will work better with Otto, so he'll follow Benno. Next is Lutz's chapter with Life of an Apprentice Merchant, where we see his daily routine of waking up early, going to work, and being a little late. His life's not easy since he's so far behind, but his effort is paying off. The main takeaways are Lutz is trying really hard to get his poor commoner habits under control, while also learning everything he can in the store. He talks to Benno to see who all knows about Mine being a shrine maiden, when he mentions someone's been asking about her around the guild. He heads home at the end of the day, and we see that his brothers are trying to bully him, but his mom steps up and makes good on her word. And lastly, we have a good chapter, framing the guildmaster to turn him from an annoying B-plot villain type into someone actively working behind Benno. So, as we all know, Benno's been trying to keep Mine safe, but Gustav is trying to keep the whole lower city safe and orderly, while from his perspective, Benno's been trashing all of his hard work. Yeah, Benno to Gustav is what Mine is to Benno. So during the tasting, he's in his office lamenting his inability to see Frida's event because his influence would skew the results. But his grandson comes to tell him about Mine being there and Benno yelling at her to change. This obviously annoys Gustav because Benno's been monopolizing Mine. That's a problem because his role as the guildmaster is to equalize profits among all parties. Mine's ideas shouldn't belong to just the Gilberta Company, but all relevant products should be given to each store to sell. That way the whole economy will prosper. He reflects on why Benno hates him a bit at this. He tried to marry Benno's mother, but not to absorb the company. It's because Benno was too young to run it, and the Gilberta Company filled a core niche. That being, high-end clothing sales to nobility. So them going under was completely unacceptable. He tried to marry Benno off to keep the store from falling apart completely due to Liz's death, but the store actually recovered and grew. He tried to marry Karina off to one of his sons to build a strong relationship with Benno, a young, sharp mind he admired from a business perspective. But at this point, the damage was already done. Each time, his family told him he was pretty much just being an insensitive idiot, but Gustav isn't quick to learn from those sort of mistakes. Not long after that, though, a weird bird literally flies through the glass window, without damaging it, and unfolds into a letter on his desk. It was from a noble saying they wanted to know about Mine.
The crazy thing here is that the side stories in this one pack in so much backstory and character motivation that's left out of the main plot. Turning the comically villainous guildmaster into a mediator who's just trying to keep order, as well as kind of looking out for Benno. Hell, Mark's side story just really gives a ton of information on why he's so loyal. Lutz's gives a good idea of how he's thriving in his new job. And just, who would have thought that Lise needed development? For real? And all of these build a bridge to the next part while also introducing a background storyline that won't pay off until part 3. But that's all for the contents of this book, so let's talk about it as a volume and wrap up this part.
At a glance, volume 3 is slightly gutted from its anime counterpart, at least if we focus on the first season. That's because some of the side story content and epilogue were pushed off to the start of the second, where it's used to bridge the gap into the events of the second part. What does that all mean? Well, mine coming home and having that moment of success is the perfect capstone to end the season on, especially if you don't know you're getting another. But mainly it lets the season end on a natural high point instead of bogging it down and foreshadowing. Now, that's important for a book though, since that sort of hook is what gets people into the next volume. Sticking the epilogue and side stories at the start of season 2 has an additional benefit of working as part recap while also showing the characters gearing up for the events in the next part of the series. I'm getting a little tired of constantly talking about how conversations are a bridge, since that's par for the course by now. And I do mean a bridge. As Mine's whole issue with the Parchment Guild is cut down to a single chibi scene, Benno buying the papermaking process and making a workshop is trimmed almost to the point of non-existence. Except for him going to the forest, that is. Plus, a few minor characters are cut out entirely, like Frida's servant learning to use Rinsham and getting Frida ready for her baptism. Essentially, 4/5 of this book is condensed down to 2 episodes, while the last 2 episodes of season 1 are the remaining 5 chapters. That might seem bad on the surface, but these scenes are more for populating the world rather than advancing the story, and when you have a tight runtime to fit, that stuff gets the axe. A major point I think some might use to critique this is how this volume backfills a lot of characters and motivation. This sort of retroactive, hey, this is why these two characters hate each other, gives a gut reaction to claim that it's lazy. But there's a big difference in execution. If this was Mine's backstory, yeah, it would be pretty damn lazy, but these are mostly side and background characters and hint at future plot points of the series. What it's backfilling isn't information that's super important, as the relationships are firmly established, and not knowing it doesn't really impact the actions of the cast. In Volume 2, Gustav's relationship with Benno doesn't really change knowing he's actually trying to look out for him, as he still acts the same from his introduction before the information to after its reveal. This sort of earmarks these details as if you're curious, as opposed to need to know. And I have to say, I am curious. Things that stand out is this book clarifies Mine's feelings for her family and why she feels so loved by them. In the chapter Oto's Counseling Room, Mine admits to herself that she considers her family there her real family now. Good thing this made it into the anime almost verbatim, though it's in a different scene. Hell, Mine even picks her family over books, something she never would have done as Arano in Rejection and Persuasion, which is just a great demonstration of her growth. We'll see that continue as the series goes on, from someone who used to barely put in effort as Arano, to someone who will turn the world upside down just to read a book for an afternoon. I will say, the temple's culture doesn't seem as developed in Volume 3 compared to later ones. The Grey Shrine Maiden Mine meets in this one is somewhat sassy, more emotive, and even volunteers information that would damage their charge. And that's basically unthinkable. An attendant Shrine Maiden would never do that later in the franchise. So it shows that the strict structure wasn't as thought through in Part 1 compared to Part 2. It's even more interesting that the priests resort to violence when ordered as, again, violence is strictly forbidden in the temple. Also interesting is Ferdinand or Bezewanst don't have attendants with them for most of their scenes. And I think that's especially odd considering Ferdinand had to leave the room to fetch a divine instrument. So he had to open the door before rushing out himself? What Grey Robe priest is gonna let him do that? I don't care how big of a hurry he's in. Plus, the two of them seem like they're on a lot friendlier terms. Or at least good at covering it up. And that I really do buy, knowing Ferdinand. This is also probably due to them having so little screen time that they don't actually have a chance to argue or butt heads. But yeah. Ferdinand seems softer as well, but this is more likely due to character evolution as the author becomes more comfortable writing for him. We see these relationships and dispositions are a lot more concrete by the time Part 2 comes around. Funnily enough, though the audience knew as early as Volume 1, it takes Mine 3 whole volumes to learn what the devouring actually is, that it's just having excess mana. This is not the first time something like this will happen, as the audience will be privy to information she's not quite often. But it's always nice to see how the series handles these reveals to Mine, as people usually just blow past them, Mine's reeling on the inside, but somehow just accept stuff, which Mine's behavior being odd to people and her internal monologue giving 2 different views is another thing we get a good glimpse at. This time from outside Mine's family, as Benno Poundcake Sampling gives insight to Mine's behavior. From an outsider's perspective, she doesn't act logically, and just rushes off to do random things that generally shake the market to its core. She doesn't have anyone protecting her at the moment, so her standing out is a bad idea. But from Mine's perspective, she's just making things she wants to ensure an easier, happier, nicer life. She doesn't consult with people for a number of reasons. She's an adult in her mind who doesn't need to, but also she's someone who's reincarnated, and when she tried to explain things like she did in Volume 1, she just got weird looks and everyone brushed her off, so consulting with someone doesn't even cross her mind. Nobody knows what she's thinking, and she runs off to do who knows what the second you take your eyes off her, is how Benno puts it to Lutz, and it's something Ferdinand will learn the hard way. And lastly, let's talk about some things you may not have noticed on your initial read. The Sovereignty and Spring Prayer are mentioned for the first time in Benno's lecture, which don't really have relevance until multiple volumes down the road. Like, the Sovereignty doesn't have much plot relevance until Part 4, and Spring Prayer doesn't have any until the second half of Part 2. I personally miss them talking about using Lutz as an intermediary to send letters to Mine's family, and that's hinted at here in Volume 3. That doesn't come into play until Volume 8, when Redacted for Masses spoilers happens. So yeah. So that's gonna do it for this volume, and part, actually. We've wrapped up the Daughter of a Soldier storyline, as Mine is no longer just that, having made it to her baptism, and finally gotten a job. But what's in store for her in the future? We'll have to find out in the next part, Prentice Shrine Maiden, where Mine joins the church proper, and has her entire worldview turned upside down. But for now, hey, you've made it to the end of the video. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, share, and do all the other YouTube stuff to help the channel grow. You can also join my Discord with a link down in the description. If you really want to support me, you can head on over to my Patreon and pick up some extra perks, like voting on what I do next. And speaking of Patreon, I'd like to give a special thanks to Nadeshko for their continued support. Thanks for watching.